Welcome back. In the previous video, we have presented the basic idea of thread circulator, and we said that the circulator is a three-port network which enables the power is transferred from port 1 to port 2, and there is no power is transferred to port 3, and the power is transferred from port 2 to port 3, and no power is transferred back to port 1, and the power is transferred from port 3 to port 1. And no power is transferred from port 3 to port 2. In the previous video, we have discussed the circulator from the point of view of the scattering matrix or S parameters. Now, we are going to discuss how to implement such a circulator by using a ferrite disk. So, starting from this video, and we have other three videos to complete this video to discuss the analysis of what we are calling strip line junction circulator. So please be patient, and you must continue these four videos to understand the complete analysis of such strip line junction circulator. To understand our plan, we are going to present the circulator as a circular resonator. And this circular resonator, if the ferrite medium is unbiased, so it would be simply a dielectric resonator. So, at the beginning, we are going to discuss the original or the dominant mode of such dielectric resonator. Then by biasing the magnetic field, this resonant frequency or this dominant mode in the circular resonator would be split into two modes. These two modes are quite close to the resonant mode of the original dielectric resonator. And these two modes depend on the biasing of the magnetic field. So, the field in this case, it would be the combination of two modes instead of one mode. And by adjusting the amplitudes of these two modes, we can make the field at port 1 is mainly concentrated at port 2, and there is no fields at port 3. In a similar way, the field at port 2 is mainly concentrated at port 3, and there is no field at port 1. So, we have obtained the function of the circulator from this concept. So, our plan is how to simulate or how to formulate the problem, how to formulate the problem as a resonator. Simply, at the beginning, without biasing magnetic field as a dielectric resonator, then by taking into consideration the effect of biasing magnetic field to be two resonant modes, and how to control these two resonant modes such that the fields will be concentrated from port 1 to port 2, and from port 2 to port 3, and from port 3 to port 1. This is our plan. And I repeat, the analysis is continued on four videos. So, this is the first video. In this case, we say that the proposed configuration for the strip line junction circulator, we have a circular metallic disc connected with three transmission line sections. These three transmission line sections are separated by an angle 120 degrees. So, they are separated symmetrically. And this circular disc, circular metallic disc, is surrounded by two ferrite discs, upper and lower ferrite disc, and they are covered by an upper ground plane and lower ground plane. So, the conducting part in this configuration represents strip line. We said that the strip line has an inner conductor and two conducting plates. So we have strip line conductor surrounded by two conducting or two ground plates. So we say that we have two ferrite disks. Fill the space between the center metallic disk and the two ground planes of the strip line. We have three strip lines. Conductors are attached to this disk at an angle 120 degrees, forming three ports of the circulator. Now, the ferrite disk here would be biased by a DC magnetic field perpendicular to the ground plane. But at the beginning, we are going to study the problem without the biasing magnetic field. So, the DC biasing magnetic field is applied normal to the ground plane. In the operation, the ferrite disks form a dielectric resonator. So, these two ferrite disks, at the beginning, they represent a dielectric resonator. To control the field from port 1 to port 2 and from port 2 to port 3, it is required to find a mode which is proportional to cosine or sine phi. So, in the absence of a bias field, this resonator has a single lowest order resonant mode with a cosine phi or sine phi dependence, which represents the number n for phi is unique. When the ferrite is magnetically biased, this mode breaks into two resonant modes. And these two resonant modes are quite close to the original mode of the unbiased ferrite. So it is breaks into two resonant modes have slightly different resonant frequencies. The operating frequency of the circulator can then be chosen so that the superposition of these two modes adds at the output board and cancel at the isolated board. So, the input signal from port 1 will be separated in two modes. These two modes have two phi dependence such that the phi dependence at port 2 will add together while the phi dependence at port 3 will cancel each other. So, the signal from port 1 would be transferred to port 2. We can analyze the junction circulator by treating it as a thin cavity resonator with electric walls at the upper or at the top and the bottom. With electric walls at the top and the bottom, and approximately magnetic walls at the side of the cylindrical shape. So, this dielectric resonator or this resonator is assumed to having a top and bottom perfect electric conducting boundary condition, and at the side it has perfect magnetic boundary condition. For the top and the bottom perfect electric boundary condition, it means that the tangential electric field at the top and the bottom it should be zero because the tangential electric field on perfect electric conductor is zero. The tangential electric field in this case is E rho and E phi. So we can say that E rho equals E phi equals zero at the bottom and at the top and the bottom of the resonator. On the other hand, the dependence or the derivative with respect to Z, it should be zero, or in other words, this mode is zero dependence on the Z direction. So, partial by partial Z, it would be zero to obtain the lowest mode in Z direction. According to this, E rho and E phi equal zero. So, the remaining part is only EZ. This means that the electric field in such resonator it would be the EZ component. And in this case, because we have inner and two ground planes, one on the upper and one on the bottom, the electric field EZ from the inner to the upper, it would be upward. And from the inner to the bottom, it would be downward. It means that the direction of the electric field at the two sides from the metallic or conducting circular disk at the middle, it would be opposite to each other. So, EZ on either side of the central conducting disk is anti-symmetric. Means that if it is upward in the upper disk, it would be downward in the lower disk. Effectively, the two disks have the same properties. So we need only to consider the solution for one flat disk, either the upper or the lower. In the circular disk, the permeability of the ferrite medium, when it would be biased, it should be taken into the form of the tensor permeability. But effectively, we have studied the tensor permeability for Cartesian coordinates, such that we said that if we have hx, hy, hz component, we can obtain bx, by, dz component by this permeability tensor, such that this is mu xx, this is mu xy, this is mu xz, and so on. However, for the present problem, it would be more suitable to formulate the problem into cylindrical coordinates. So, it is required now to obtain the equivalent permeability tensor instead of in Cartesian coordinates, it would be in cylindrical coordinates. So we are going to start with converting the magnetic field in Cartesian coordinates to be in cylindrical coordinates. So to obtain the raw component of the magnetic field or the magnetic flux density B rho, in this case B rho, it would be Bx cosine phi plus By sine phi. So in terms of the Cartesian coordinates, we can obtain the cylindrical component of the magnetic flux density B. Bx from here, Bx equal mu multiplied by Hx plus J kappa multiplied by Hy. So we can replace Bx by mu Hx plus J kappa Hy. On the other hand, By can be obtained from the Cartesian coordinates as minus j kappa hx plus mu hy. So, b rho in terms of bx cosine phi plus by sine phi, they can be represented in terms of hx hy in this form. Now, we can take the hx component cosine phi, mu hx cosine phi minus j kappa hx sine phi, and we can replace the value of hx by h rho cosine phi plus h phi sine phi. Why? Hy would be h rho sine phi minus h phi cosine phi. So by replacing hx and hy by their equivalent components in terms of h rho and h phi, we can obtain b rho in terms of h rho and h phi. By doing this, we can find out b rho equals mu h rho plus j kappa h phi. In a similar way, we can represent b phi as minus bx sine phi plus by cosine phi. So we are going to replace bx by mu hx plus j kappa hy, and we are going to replace by by minus j kappa hx plus mu hy. Once again, we are going to replace hx by h rho cosine phi plus h phi sine phi. And we are going to replace hy by minus hy. It would be replaced by h rho sine phi minus h phi cosine phi. And by doing this, we can represent b phi in terms of h rho and h phi as minus J kappa H phi plus mu H phi. The third component for Cartesian coordinate is the Z component, which is the same for the Cartesian coordinate. So in the Cartesian coordinates, BZ equals mu naught HZ, which is exactly the same as in Cartesian coordinates. Now, by combining B rho in terms of H rho and H phi, and B phi in terms of H rho and H phi, we can obtain the equivalent permeability tensor mu in cylindrical coordinates. So, in this case, we find that B rho, it would be mu H phi plus J kappa. Sorry, mu H rho plus J kappa H phi. And B phi, it would be minus J kappa H rho plus mu H phi. And BZ equals mu naught HZ. So, effectively, the resultant permeability tensor mu is exactly the same as in the case of the Cartesian coordinates. It's exactly the same as the case of the Cartesian coordinates. So mu here, or the permeability tensor, is the same matrix as for the rectangular coordinates. So if you are interested in finding out the magnetic flux density from the magnetic field in cylindrical coordinates, we are going to use this relation. Now, let us return back to the cylindrical cavity here. And we said that the dependence on Z is constant, so partial by partial Z is zero. And we are going to use Maxwell's curl equation. Maxwell's curl equation, we have two equations, curl E equals minus J omega mu H, and curl H equals J omega epsilon E. So, for curl E equals minus J omega mu H, we have only EZ component, and the derivative with respect to Z is zero. So, from this, the only remaining term in the direction of rho is 1 over rho partial EZ by partial phi. This is the rho component of curl E. This should equal minus J omega mu in the rho direction. In the rho direction, according to the permeability tensor, which we have already obtained for cylindrical coordinates, is minus J omega mu H rho plus J kappa H phi. On the other hand, the phi component of curl E, it would be minus partial EZ by partial rho. And this phi component, it would equal minus J omega mu H. And in this case, by applying the tensor for the cylindrical coordinates, it would be minus J omega multiplied by minus J kappa H rho plus mu H phi. So, these two equations represent Faraday's law. Curl E equals minus J omega mu H. And the third equation should represent Ampere's law, which is curl E equals J omega epsilon E. Curl H equals J omega epsilon E. So, in this case, curl H would be only having Z component, because we don't have any electric field except in the Z component. So the Z component of curl H is 1 over rho partial rho H phi by partial rho minus partial H rho by partial phi. This equals the Z component of J omega epsilon E. It would be J omega epsilon EZ, where epsilon here is the permittivity of the ferrite medium. Okay? Now we have driving the equations which will be used to obtain the wave equation inside this resonator. Now, by using the two equations of Faraday's law, here we find it. We have H rho and H phi in terms of the derivative of EZ. And here we have H rho and H phi in terms of the derivative of Ez. So we can arrange these two equations to obtain H rho in terms of Ez only and H phi in terms of Ez only. For example, here if I multiply both sides by minus J kappa, and in the second equation, if I have multiplied both sides by mu, and I have subtracted these two equations after multiplying this by minus J kappa and this by my mu, I'll extract the term H rho. So the remaining part, it would be H phi, so I can find H phi in terms of Ez only. In a similar way, if I multiply the first equation by mu and the second equation by minus J kappa, and I have added these two equations after multiplying, so I can find a relation between H rho and Ez only. So from these two equations, we can obtain H rho in terms of Ez only and H phi in terms of Ez only. By doing this, we have two terms, Y and K. K here is defined as K squared equals omega squared epsilon multiplied by mu squared minus kappa squared over mu, which is effectively omega squared epsilon mu E, which is the extraordinary permeability of the ferrite medium. And this represents the effective wave number of the ferrite medium. On the other hand, the term Y is simply square root epsilon over mu extraordinary, which is the effective characteristic admittance of the ferrite medium. Alright? So, now we have H rho and H phi in terms of Ez only. Let us return back to the three equations. The third equation, it was the relation between H phi and H rho and Ez. So, now, if we are going to take H rho as a function of Ez only and put it here in this equation, and we take H phi as a function of Ez only and put it here in this equation, we can find an equation for Ez only. So, the resulting equation for Ez only is partial squared Ez by partial rho squared plus 1 over rho partial Ez by partial rho plus 1 over rho squared partial squared Ez by partial phi squared plus k squared Ez equals 0. This is effectively quite similar to the wave equation for the TEM mode in a circular waveguide where we have the wave in terms of Ez. So, this equation is identical in form to the equation of Ez for the TEM mode, transverse magnetic mode, of a circular waveguide. If we remember, the general solution for this wave equation, it was that Ez of the mode n equal the amplitude of plus n multiplied by e to the power j n phi plus the amplitude of minus n e to the power minus j n phi. This is dependent on the azimuth direction phi multiplied by the Bessel function j of order n of k rho. And it should be noted here, the general solution can be represented in terms of the Bessel function j and terms of the Bessel function y. But the Bessel function for I, or the Bessel function of second kind, has singularity, or it is infinity, at rho equals 0. So, we are going to take the amplitude of the function Y to be 0, such that to avoid the field singularity at the origin, or at the rho equals 0. So, to make the field is finite value at rho equals 0, we have chosen the Bessel function of first kind J. Okay? So, the general solution for the electric field inside such resonator is A plus N multiplied by E to the power J N phi plus A minus N multiplied by E to the power minus J N phi multiplied by the dependence on rho Gn of k rho. And it should be noted here, we have represented the phi dependence in two terms of two modes, one in positive direction and the other in negative direction. And according to the amplitude A plus N or A minus N, the field it may be completely in positive N or it may be completely in negative N. Now, this is the electric field EZ. From this electric field, we are going to apply this electric field in the equation of H phi in terms of EZ to find out the magnetic field of the different mode or of the nth mode inside such a resonator. So, the magnetic field H phi of nth mode in such a resonator by applying this EZ in this equation, it would be minus GY multiplied by A plus N e to the power JN phi multiplied by the first derivative of the Bessel function J dash N of K rho plus N kappa over K rho mu multiplied by the Bessel function Jn of K rho. This is the first term or correspond to the mode plus N. The mode minus N is A minus N, the amplitude, multiplied by the dependence on phi e to the power minus Jn phi multiplied by J dash N of K rho, where J dash is the first derivative of the Bessel function. Instead of plus, it is minus N kappa over K rho mu multiplied by J N of K rho. Now, let us assume that this ferrite medium is unbiased with any magnetic field. So, if it is unbiased with any magnetic field, this means that the biasing magnetic field H naught is zero and the saturation magnetization is zero. So in this case, the precession frequency omega naught is zero and the magnetization frequency omega m is zero. So the value of mu is effectively mu naught. The value of mu and the extraordinary permeability mu e is simply is mu naught. And the value of kappa in this case is zero. So, for a special case, if the ferrite medium is not magnetized, if the ferrite medium is not magnetized, such that H naught equals zero and the saturation magnetization equals zero, so the precession frequency equals zero and the magnetization frequency equals zero. So, in this case, the value of kappa is zero and the value of mu is simply mu naught. In this case, this equation, it would be simply A plus N e to the power Jn phi J dash K rho plus 0 because kappa is 0. And the second term is A minus N e to the power minus Jn phi J dash of K rho minus 0. So effectively in this case the dependence it would be simply J dash N of K rho. On the other hand, at the resonant frequency, we said that the boundary condition, we have a perfect electric conductor at the top and perfect electric conductor at the bottom and perfect magnetic conductor at the sides of the circular disk. So, for the perfect magnetic conductor, the tangential magnetic field H phi in this case, it should be zero. So, at the resonant mode, H phi of the mode N, it should be zero at rho equals A at the sides of the cylinder of the resonator. So, the resonant frequency of this mode, it can be obtained that by setting up H rho, H phi equals 0 at rho equals A, we can obtain the resonant mode. And we said that for either for the mode plus N or mode minus N, the dependence on rho is simply J dash N of K rho. So, the condition for the resonance in this case is that J dash of N multiplied by of K of rho when rho equals A, it should be zero. So the resonance condition in this case is simply J dash N of KA equals zero. Or in other words, the value of KA equals the first root of the first mode of the Bessel function which is B11 dash, if you remember from the TM mode in circular waveguide, it was 1.841. So, in other words, we can say that the resonant frequency K, it would be 1.841 over the value of A. Add this value, K here equals omega over C, or omega over square root, omega square, K equals omega square root mu epsilon. Omega equals square root mu epsilon. So, in this case, the resonant frequency, omega, and we are going to call omega naught, but please take care, this is not the precession frequency. This is the resonant frequency of the dominant mode for the ferrite disk when it is unbiased. Omega naught here, it is not the precession frequency. It is the resonant frequency for the circular ferrite disk when it is unbiased. So, omega naught in this case, it would be x naught, which is B11 dash, over the value of A, over square root mu effective or mu extraordinary multiplied by epsilon. And we said that mu extraordinary in this case would be simply mu naught, and epsilon here is the permittivity of the ferrite medium. So it would be epsilon naught multiplied by epsilon r, where epsilon r is the relative permittivity of the ferrite medium. So from this we have obtained the resonant frequency for unbiased ferrite disk. In the following video, we are going to find out the resonant modes around this resonant mode for biased ferrite medium. So, if we are going to bias ferrite medium by DC magnetic field, this resonant mode will be deviated with two resonant modes. And this two resonant mode, one is smaller than omega naught, and one is slightly bigger than omega naught. So we are going to call it omega 1 and omega 2, such that omega 1 is less than omega naught, and omega naught is less than omega 2. So we are going to find out omega 1 and omega 2, which are the resonant frequency for the ferrite disk when it is biased by a magnetic field. Okay? Let me see you in the next video. And as I said, the following three videos will complete the analysis of such strip line junction circuitry.